There's a call comes ringing o'er the restless waves. Send the light,
send the light,
send the light,
send the light.
There are souls to rescue, there are souls to save. Send the light,
send the light,
send the light,
send the light.
We will spread,
we will spread
the everlasting light
with the wind,
with the wind,
giving heart in hand,
giving heart in hand,
giving God,
giving God
the glory.
Evermore
we will follow,
we will follow
His
command.
Send the light,
send the light,
the blessed
gospel light,
let it shine,
let it shine,
from shore to shore,
from shore to shore.
Send the light,
send the light,
and let it change
your themes,
light the world,
light the world,
forevermore.
Good evening, good morning, good afternoon, wherever you're joining us from. We are so glad that you could join us again. God has been so good to us over these past 2+ years where we have been studying the Word of God, where we have been worshiping together faithfully week after week on this online platform. We thank those of you who have been with us from the beginning, way back in 2020. And we also appreciate those of you who this might be your first week joining us. You know, we have a lot of new speakers who will be joining us for this upcoming month. And I'll tell you just a little bit more about that in just a second. And so if you are a visitor, if you are new to this program, we welcome you and we thank you for joining us. And we ask that the Holy Spirit will bless you both now and after the program. The reason why I'm so excited about these upcoming few weeks is because we are starting a new series entitled, You Are Gonna Make It. You are going to make it. In order to usher in this theme of you're going to make it, we have 5 young people from the Hershey, Pennsylvania Seventh-day Adventist Church, where our good friend, Pastor Ryan Musser, is pastor. Starting this week and continuing for the next 4, we are going to be having young people from that church having conversations with Pastor Ryan Musser about the theme, You Are Going to Make It. We are so excited to kick things off today. Today we have Tsahai Johnson, who is going to be speaking in conversation with Pastor Musser to us about the topic, There Is No Condemnation in Christ Jesus. Amen. There is no condemnation in Christ Jesus. And as we progress through the next few weeks, I will introduce to you the other young people of that church who will be presenting and conversating with us. You know, we want to get right into the program because we are so excited to talk about this theme, You Are Gonna Make It. I just wanted to quickly share with you a verse from Psalms that I think will usher in the mood for this new series. Psalms chapter 30, verse 5 says, For his anger is but for a moment, his favor is for life. Weeping may endure for a night, but joy comes in the morning. I'm so glad that I serve a God that has his favor fixated on life. I am so glad that I serve a God that is focused on prospering me, that has plans to enrich my life. A God that promises me that I may go through some hard times now, but in the future, things are going to be all right. Let's have a word of prayer and continue with the rest of our program. Father God, we thank you so much for your providence in our lives. Lord, we are so tired of all the challenges that we have experienced recently and even in the past few years, Lord, with this pandemic. But we thank you, Lord, for shining down upon us and showing us, such as in verses here in Psalms 30, that we may go through weeping for a moment, but joy is sure to come in the morning. Lord, we ask that you will bless our participants, both who will be presenting and those who will be listening. We ask, Father, that you will pour out a spirit on all of us, Father, so that we can become better Christians and we can draw closer to you. We thank you, Lord, for your grace and your mercy. Bless us, Father, in Christ's name I pray. Amen.
Who stands in the fire? This is Vitaly. He's 10 years old, and he lives in a country called Kyrgyzstan. Every Sabbath, boys and girls in Vitaly's church are invited to listen to a children's story. After the story, the storyteller always asks, "Did any of you memorize a Bible verse this week?" Any child who memorized a verse gets to recite it for the whole church to hear. For the past year, 10-year-old Vitaly has raised his hand and shared a Bible verse every Sabbath. Why do you think he memorizes a Bible verse each week? When a friend asked him, Vitaly smiled shyly and said, "I memorize verses as a gift to God." You see, the Sabbath school teacher always reminds Vitaly and the other children of something important. She says, "Every day, God gives us many gifts. What gift do you have for God today?" God has given Vitaly many gifts. He lives with his loving grandparents. He has a home and a warm bed. He goes to a good school. He has food to eat. But Vitaly didn't have any money or toys to give his gifts to God. He wondered for a long time, "What gift can I give to God?" Then Vitaly thought about how well he can remember things. He decided to memorize a verse from the Bible every week. His Sabbath school teacher said this would be a wonderful gift for God. He isn't nervous anymore when he stands up in front at church because he does it every week. Vitaly is one of six children in Kyrgyzstan who go to church every Sabbath, even though no one else in their families is an Adventist. The children stand outside their homes on Sabbath mornings and wait for the Sabbath school teacher to pick them up in her car. After church, she drives them home. These children like church so much that they go every week no matter what. When it snows a lot and other children stay in their warm homes, Vitaly and the others go to church. When the weather is warm and the other children play outside, they still go to church. The pastor is glad that they're so faithful about spending Sabbath with God. In fact, little Vitaly loves church so much that he told his older brother about it, and now he goes to church too. Vitaly is in the fourth grade at Heritage Christian School in Kyrgyzstan. He loves his school because he gets to learn about God every day. Part of this quarter's 13 Sabbath offerings will help Heritage Christian School. Did you know that the school is named after a Bible verse? Psalm 127:3 says, "Children are a heritage from the Lord." That means children are a special gift that God gives to parents. Please remember Heritage Christian School in your prayers and with your Sabbath school mission offerings.
Happy Sabbath!
Hi, Mission Exchange. My name is Zin, and I am here with my friends,
Ashley,
Chilandu,
and we are singing from Victoria, BC. The song we'll be singing is called "Fill Me Up."
You provide the fire. I'll provide the sacrifice.
You will pour out the Spirit.
I will open up inside.
Fill me up, God. Fill me up, God. Fill me up, God. Fill me up.
Fill me up, God. Fill me up, God. Fill me up, God. Fill me up.
You provide the fire.
I'll provide the sacrifice. Sacrifice.
You will pour out your Spirit.
We will open up so you can fill us up, God. Fill us up, God. Fill us up, God. Fill us up. Fill us up, God. Fill us up, God. Fill us up, God. Fill us up. Love, love, God. Overflow, permeate all my soul, love of God, overflow, permeate all our souls. Fill me up, fill me up, oh. Fill me up, fill me up, oh. Come heal me.
So welcome back to our Zoom church. Over the next few weeks, we are going to be studying through my absolute favorite chapter in the entire New Testament. We're going to be looking at Romans chapter 8, which I absolutely love. And as you can see, I have a guest. Over the next few weeks, I'm really, really committed to and excited about having some of the young leaders that are in and around my church joining me for a discussion-based sermon-style message. So today we're going to be looking at the first few verses of Romans chapter 8. We'll see how far we get. My plan is to get to at least verse 4, maybe a little bit past that if we have time. But really what I want to model for you and your family and your homes is that truth is an emergent property. I think truth comes out of discussing and studying together. Paul has this really great quote where he says, "Do not forsake the assembling of each other, even as you see the day approaching," right? And as we see God is coming, our tendency with COVID and with many things would be to insulate. And there's a lot of importance in studying the Bible by yourself, right? Devotional style, that's not to be neglected, but you need to be studying together. So I'm hoping to model that. I'm really excited. This is my young friend, Sahai, one of my closest friends, absolute beautiful human being that I love so much. So I got her to do our first one. So what we're going to do is we're going to pray, and then we're going to get into Romans chapter 8, and I really hope that this, the next few weeks, that they just go really well. So I'll ask Sahai to pray for us, and then we'll start studying. Go ahead.
Right. Dear Heavenly Father, thank you for this chance to come together and to discuss and to read into your word and to learn more about you. I pray that everything that we say will come from you, and I pray that the words we speak will touch the hearts of anyone that is listening and will be what they need to hear. In Jesus' name, I ask this prayer. Amen.
Amen. So I thought probably the coolest thing to do at the very beginning would just be to get like a very brief overview of Romans chapter 8 by just kind of looking at the fact that Romans 8 is not emotional musings. It's not it's not Paul saying, you know, I recently heard on a podcast someone was kind of talking about like Christian sexuality and how sexuality is beneficial. And it is, right? God created sexuality and it's beautiful, right? But they were saying a lot of like, well, I feel this, and I feel like God is this, and using very little scripture. And they were actually saying like things that were contrary to scripture. And it was just like, I feel, and I believe, and it was not rooted in scripture. Anyway, so I wanted to point out the opposite of that. So I thought what we would do is just kind of look through. So he starts in chapter 8 by saying, there is, what does your say?
Therefore.
There is therefore. And then verse 2, the very first word would be?
For.
For. Verse 3?
For.
For. If you jump down to verse 5.
Four again. Yeah.
Four, and then verse 6. Four, and then as he gets later into the chapter, he says things like, not only that, verse 12, it says, therefore, mm-hmm. and verse 14, four, verse 15, four. And then at the very end, which we'll get to several weeks from now, verse 38 says, for I am persuaded. And I just love that he's not doing like this emotional, like I said, like, well, I feel that God is with us, and God created emotions, and emotions are beautiful, right? But I just love that it's like, for this, I am persuaded. This is logical and it's rational. I don't know if you have any thoughts on that. You just jump in whenever you want, but...
I mean, I think when it comes to feelings, that's how we like to be led, but it's not a strong foundation to be on.
I love the way you said that.
And so it's comforting to me, actually. Like, it's comforting when you hear people talk about, I feel this way or I feel that way, but it's even more comforting when I see like this, like it's a logical kind of explanation, and I feel grounded in what he's saying.
I love the way you said that. Feelings are beautiful, and God created emotions, right? And they have an incredible purpose, but it has to be also grounded in logic, because
right.
you can feel incorrectly, right? You can feel, I feel that, you know, but that very thing that you're feeling like is correct could be incorrect.
Right. I always think of the verse that says, the heart is deceitful above all things.
What a great example.
You always hear people say, follow your heart, do what your heart tells you. And sometimes that's just completely wrong.
It can be, yeah. I feel like God is leading me in this direction. And that can, you know, through prayer and studying scripture, right? Feelings are not, I'm not saying anything about how feelings should be ignored, right? But you certainly can be deceived.
Yeah.
So I love that he's just, it's grounded in logic. So to kind of set this up, I thought we would actually jump back a few verses and jump back to the end of chapter 7. So maybe we should just read like chapter 27, chapter 7, verse 24 and 25. Do you want to read it?
Yeah, sure. Oh, wretched man that I am, who will deliver me from this body of death? I thank God, through Jesus Christ our Lord. So then, with the mind, I myself serve the law of God, but with the flesh, the law of sin.
So, one of the things that I think people come to Romans and they see Paul saying is that the law is almost like non-useful, like it doesn't do anything.
Mm-hmm.
I don't know if you have any thoughts or if you wanted to jump in on that. He's saying like, and we're about to get that into that in chapter 8, but I think it's really important to recognize the law is extremely important. But it's also impotent to do what it was never designed to do, which is to save you. Like, the law can't save you.
Right.
Right? So he's not saying, and we're going to get into this, like, he's crying out to God, why do I keep doing the things that I don't want to do, and I keep doing the things that I don't want to do? Did I say that right? I'm not doing the things that I want to do.
Right.
But then the things that I don't want to do, those are the things that I actually find myself doing. And he has
yeah.
a verse very similar to that earlier in chapter 7. I don't know.
I think when, at least for me especially, like, I've read this scripture so many times, but, like, the first few times reading it, you think of law and you think of, like, the Ten Commandments, and it feels like, why is he using the word law? And I think the word law gets people confused. Like, what's the law of sin and what's the law of God?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah,
the word law here actually refers to the entire Torah, I believe. I don't know. I'm not certain on that, but I feel like what you, like if you were going to come to the end of chapter 7, if you were reading down through chapter 7 and you had someone saying something like this, oh, wretched man that I am, who will deliver me from this body of death? I think the natural follow-up from some people would be, like, you idiot, like, you keep doing the same thing over and over again, you know what I mean? Like a dog going back to its vomit, you keep failing over and over, so do better. Right, I don't know. I don't know if you've ever heard someone. I don't think they would ever say it so rudely, but they would probably have that idea. I don't know if you've ever
yeah,
heard people say that.
Definitely, I've heard people say like this is not working out for you because you're not doing this right, or you're like you're sinning, and it's like we'll always be sinning. So, is God just constantly punishing us because we're not doing things perfectly? And I think if we view God that way, then we'll just keep on trying and trying and trying and never get there, rather than working on the relationship with God and trying to know God more.
I love that you said the word relationship. We're going to come to relationship a little bit later. Towards the end, I was thinking about how law connects to the Ten Commandments and how the Ten Commandments is actually a relationship. So I love that you said that.
Mm-hmm.
So I actually had a story in mind that I was thinking about. So there was a church, and I won't say which church this is. After church, some of the most pious saints, they would just kind of get together and they would read through like testimonies to the church or some kind of like hard Ellen White, you know. And there was a lady who didn't really fit the mold of that afternoon thing. She was accepted in the church, right? She was very, she had like huge hair. She had like a really nice sports car. And she didn't fit the churchy mold, right? But she was accepted by the church. And so they invited her to this Sabbath afternoon thing, and she didn't come to church every week. She was kind of like, she was growing, right? And I remember she was sitting, and so she's sitting there, and he's reading down through about something like, sin is bad. I don't know if you knew that. Like, sin is wrong, and how you shouldn't do that, right?
Yeah.
And she raised her hand and she said something like, what happens if you knew you shouldn't have done something, but you did it anyway, right?
Yeah.
Like, she had this idea of something that she had clearly just done. And she said it in a way that was so obvious that she was repentant and she was remorseful. And maybe, like her eyes were watering or she was trembling. Like, it was very obvious.
Mm-hmm.
And everybody got really uncomfortable. And then the leader said something like, and I was like, oh my goodness, I can't wait to hear what this guy's going to say. And he said something like, well, it would have been better if you didn't sin. And I was just like, shocker, right? Like,
yeah.
She clearly needed to hear something like the gospel of Jesus Christ, which is exactly what comes right after verse 25, into
right.
chapter 8, verse 1. There is, therefore, now no condemnation to those who are in Jesus.
Right.
Go ahead.
It's kind of jumping ahead a little bit into chapter 8, but I like how it says there's no condemnation in those who are in Christ Jesus, not... It doesn't say there's no condemnation to those who walk according to the Spirit. It says there's no condemnation to those who are in Christ Jesus, and the characterization of those people is they walk in the Spirit, but it's not like...
I love the way you said that.
You know what I mean?
Yeah. It's not just... Yeah. Who according to the Spirit, right? They're not walking according to the flesh, but according to the Spirit. Why? Because they're in Christ Jesus.
Right. It's not like you're in Christ Jesus because you're doing correctly. It's the opposite way.
Yes. It's the relationship. You are now in Christ Jesus, which helps you walk not according to the flesh, but walk according to the Spirit.
Right.
I love that. And there's actually a lot of language here. Like, there's so many things that are popping out, and we won't have time to get to all of them. But walking according to the Spirit, I don't know if you remember this. In the creation account, God breathed into Adam, and that's the imagery of the Holy Spirit,
right?
Like, the fact that we are coming to life as new Christians, right? As like, in baptism, we go under and we die to ourselves, and then we come up according to the Spirit, right? Like, there's all this imagery in the creation account. Like, all of these things are crossing over, and we don't have time to talk about all of them.
Yeah, I didn't even think about that.
But according to the Spirit. And I love the order that you're saying. When you are... How do you get in Jesus? You become baptized.
Right.
That's what he spends all of Romans chapter 6 talking about. And we won't go through that. But if you haven't been baptized, if you have been baptized, then this verse applies to you. There is no condemnation for those of us who are in Christ Jesus. Like, that's amazing.
Right. Yeah.
Your verdict is innocence.
I think it's so much easier to say to somebody, or so much more helpful to say, you're no longer condemned, while they're still sinning, to help them move along, rather than waiting until you think they're perfect enough to tell them they're no longer condemned.
I think you're exactly right. People grow from acceptance,
right,
not in order to gain acceptance.
Right.
Right? That never works, because the goalpost just keeps moving further. And so that's why Jesus says, if you've been baptized, well, Paul is really saying it, but
yeah,
it's the same idea that Jesus would also say many times, you have no condemnation. Right? You have no condemnation. It's actually really cool because if you go back to Romans chapter 3, verse 24, here's a really cool idea. Paul says, and this, Paul is just so intelligent. I love how, I mean, his mind, he was so intelligent. So in chapter 3, verse 24, it says, being justified freely by his grace through the redemption that is what?
In Christ Jesus.
In Christ Jesus, right? The redemption is in Jesus. And then the same thing he says in Romans chapter 8, verse 1, your no condemnation is located, and this is exactly what you just said,
right, in Christ Jesus.
In Christ Jesus, right? When you are in Jesus, you have no condemnation. It's not located, your no condemnation is not located in your law keeping,
right?
Like, in your Sabbath keeping or in your tithe returnings. It's located in Jesus, which produces exactly what you said, not walking according to the flesh, but walking according to the Spirit. Right. So, or did you have something you wanted to jump in with?
I was just going to say that's so much more secure. Like, to think that my righteousness is in myself, I'd constantly be doubting
yes.
my righteousness. But to know that
goes
it's
up
in
and down.
Jesus, yeah, it's like, he won't fail me.
He will not fail me. See, I'm so glad I invited you. I think about this, I love that you said it's so secure. I was thinking about this like this. Like, we currently are in Hershey, Pennsylvania, right? So if I was not here in Hershey and I wanted to use my phone, my GPS, to say, oh, take me to Hershey, Pennsylvania. I want to be in Hershey, right? And it would say, take a left here or take a right there or take a left here, then go down this street. And you're now in Hershey. If I was going to use GPS technology to get me to my no condemnation, it would take me to being in Jesus, right? And I just, I love that idea, or my redemption that he said in Romans chapter 3, I would use that GPS technology to take me to, how do I get to in Jesus? Because that's the, my destination is no condemnation,
yeah,
like in Jesus. Yeah.
Yeah.
I don't know if you wanted to add anything to that, but.
No.
So I wanted to illustrate it like this. I know I have a paper here somewhere. I have them all over my Bible. So, you actually wrote this for me. This is the letter that you wrote for me. I won't pull it out now. So here's what we'll do. When you become baptized, you this if this is your life is now located in Christ Jesus, right? Like the Bible, if God looks at Jesus, he looks at you and he sees Jesus, right? Your life has been subsumed by Jesus because you are now located like in, like if the Bible is Jesus, right? I just think that's such a great metaphor for showing, again, your salvation and your no condemnation, your redemption is not located in your lawkeeping.
Right.
It's secure in Jesus.
And it's such a beautiful illustration of God's grace, like to take us as sinful as we are and to look at us as Jesus.
Yeah.
And it makes me think like, why can't we look at other people that way?
Oh, that is such a great thought.
You know.
Yeah. Expand on that.
Like we're so judgmental. Like I'm in high school and kids are judgmental all the time. And even being in a Christian school, it's like, how can we learn to look at people as what they can be as a child of God rather than the sin that they have, because we're just as sinful, you know? But it just tells me of the unending like capabilities of God's grace, that he could take someone so far from the character of Jesus and view us the same way.
And I think that by doing that, and I wasn't planning on saying this, but by doing that, by looking at someone as something that they could be, which is what God does to us in Jesus, he looks at us like, you are succeeding and you're doing well. That actually produces the growth.
Right.
Right? Because he looks at not just not just current reality, but possibilities. And he looks at potential and he sees like, right now you are a sinner in need of a savior and you can get to this location, right? You can grow in Jesus, but you're not going to get it apart from Jesus. So that's why you need to be in Jesus. And God looks at possibilities. Like he sees what we are not yet, but what we could become,
yeah,
which is really cool.
I always think like whenever, if I become a parent, I always told myself when I'm talking to my kids, if let's say they do something stupid or silly, I don't want to say, why are you being stupid? I want to say, I know you're smarter than that.
Oh, I love the way you said that. Yeah.
Because it's like you say things and people believe what you say. You know, and then it like becomes their reality.
Yeah.
So if you keep telling someone, I know you're smarter, even if it doesn't seem like they are, they'll grow.
That's exactly what God does to us, and how God tells us as parents, right? As a dad, try to do the same thing with my daughter.
Right.
I know you're intelligent. I know you can behave. You are a smart little girl. That's very well said. A connection that I hadn't made to this verse. So I thought what we should do is just kind of read down through 2, 3, and 4. Let's read through a couple more verses. Why don't you read 2, 3, yeah, 2 and 3. Let's
okay.
Start there.
For the law of the Spirit of life in Christ Jesus has made me free from the law of sin and death. For what the law could not do, in that it was weak through the flesh, God did by sending his own Son in the likeness of sinful flesh on account of sin. He condemned sin in the flesh.
There is so much going on here, which is why I wanted to go verse by verse with a fine-tooth comb. I love the connection. Remember, he's reasoning, right? He's going from A to B, from B to C to D. And by the end of chapter 8, he says, I am persuaded, as near as I can tell.
Right.
I am persuaded, right? And you're going to be persuaded too, and so am I, right? Like, there's no way to believe anything opposite that God loves us and nothing is able to separate us. That's when we get to the very end. But I love the way that he does that. The reason why I said that is because there is therefore now no condemnation. And then verse 2, for or because the law of the Spirit of life in Christ Jesus has made me free from the law of sin and death. For what the law couldn't do, God did.
Right.
Remember, and I said this idea before, the law can't do what it was never designed to do. Right? Like, I don't know, this might be a little bit of a silly example, but a mirror was never designed to comb my hair. It was to show me that my hair needs to be combed, right? Like, the law was never designed to save us. What the law was designed to do was to show us that we do need a savior. right? So Paul's not saying that the law is not important or that we don't need the law. He's saying you do need the law, but what you need more is Jesus,
right,
to help you.
I think two, like, extreme kind of ways that we tend to look at the law is either, like you said, say the law is a mirror, and it's, like, either the law is going to clean me up, or the mirror is what's dirty, and that's why it's making me look dirty.
Interesting.
And it's, like, there's a problem with the law, not with me, and so it's, like, the people who reject the law and say, we don't need that anymore, there's a problem with that, it's too strict, it's too whatever it may be, and then on the other side, people thinking the law is everything and it's what's going to save me.
Oh, yes. Interesting. So there's one of those two extremes.
Right. And we have to find the middle of it's Christ that saves me and the law is kind of showing that
I'm
the
still
product
faulty.
of being saved.
Yeah. Yeah. The law is what we're still aspiring to. Like, God still wants to change us and help
right.
us to grow. So I thought it was interesting that the word law actually pops up twice. And I think this is so key. This is such a huge point. In verse 2, it says, the law of the spirit of life
mm-hmm.
has set me free from the law of sin and death. So there's two laws. I don't know if you've noticed this idea before in scripture or not, probably, because you're very intelligent. But the same thing that brings life to the believer actually brings death to the unbeliever. Right?
Right.
Very many times in scripture, God's love, right? God's love is, you know, for those of us who love Jesus and have Jesus as our Savior, God encompasses us with a hug and just loves us. But that same hug would crush out the life of a non-believer. Does that make sense?
Oh, yeah.
The cross is another great example. The cross sealed Satan's fate, but sealed our fate as believers. So anyway, to use that idea, there's two laws here. The law of the Spirit and the law of sin and death. Jesus does not change. Right? You are the one that changes. You submit your life to Jesus, and that is what determines whether it's the law of spirit of life, the law of life, or the law of sin and death. It's the same law, right? The rules are the rules, right? Jesus says, I'm not going to change the rules, not because they can't be changed, but because to change them, like, it doesn't make any sense, right? Lying is not good for you one day and then not the next day. Like, no, lying is always bad for you, right? Like, the rules are the rules for a reason. They're fixed. They're not arbitrary and random. So I can't change the rules, but I can change your heart. So you can either come to me as the law of spirit of life, or if you reject me, it becomes the same law, which now brings you sin and death.
Wow. I didn't realize that.
Yeah, I just love the way that the word law is there twice. The law of the spirit of life in Jesus has set me free from the original law, right? That's what he's saying in verse 2. The law of the light of spirit of life, Jesus has set me free. And again, it's all rotated. It's all, like, it revolves around Jesus. Everything revolves around Jesus. Are you in Jesus? Right?
It's so funny that you said the law doesn't change, because although it's, like, something that I know, I hadn't really thought of it in that kind of way. Like, it doesn't make sense for, at one point, God to say, do not steal, and then to say, actually, no, now it's okay. And I've heard people say, like, the Ten Commandments were written so long ago. How can they apply to us in 2022? But it's like, even as much as society and the world changes, the law is universal.
Yeah.
And I think that's a really, I want to say secure, not exactly secure, but like it makes
stable.
Like stable. Like, it makes me know, like, no matter what changes, this is still a standard that I can look to.
I love what you're saying, and I hadn't thought about going in this direction, but the law all boils down to, Jesus says this, love.
Yeah.
Right? And I've heard many people say things like, oh, do we still need to follow the law? The law is not important. You know, the law, it's so old, it's so outdated, it's so dusty and antiquated. We don't need to follow the law anymore. But the idea of the law is love, right? Love for God first, and then love your neighbor as yourself. And I don't think we have anything better than that today. Right? It's not like, is there something about the passage of time that makes what used to be good no longer good?
Right.
Right? Like, love was always amazing, and then now, all of a sudden, selfishness became better. No, it didn't.
Yeah.
Right? The law doesn't change because it's rooted in love, and love didn't change. Other-centered love. I care about you more than I care about me.
I think that's so beautiful that it's centered in love, and we don't have to feel like we're being bossed around and told, do this or do that, because I just want to restrict you and tell you what
right.
not what to do and what you have to do and what you can't do. And it's more just like a parent. Like, I love you here's how you're going to be able to live your best life.
Oh, I love the way you said that. Here's how you're able to live your best life. God is not some Scrooge sitting up on the throne of the universe, right? Like looking to steal joy, but he loves us. He looks at us and he's like, you're my child and I love you. And I know what's going to make you the happiest. Follow these things.
Right.
Right. That's what it's rooted in. So that's why the law doesn't change, right? Which all kind of comes out of verse 2. And then verse 3, which you already read, it says, for what the law could not do and that it was weak through the flesh, God did. I just love those two words. What the law could not do, God did. Because the law was never designed to save us. God did. The law condemned us to death. Are you ready for this? Mm-hmm. But God condemned sin to death, right? So the law condemned us.
Yeah.
But then God condemned sin through the cross. At the cross, God condemned, okay, at some day, sin is going to die. Or it's both a then and a future thing, right? It's now, then, and future, right? The fate is sealed, but God saved us. What the law could not do, God did. I just love that. So you probably think, and I think many times, man, I can't stop doing this. I can't stop doing that. I can't start, you know, whatever. But God did. God already did, right?
Yeah.
In Jesus. And so the more that you are in Jesus and the more that you surrender to him, God already did.
Wow. Yeah.
It's just amazing to me. I don't know if you have any thoughts on verse 3. Anything that sticks out to you?
I just think that sticks out really personally to me because I'm a very logical person and I'm a to-do list kind of person. And so even when it comes to my faith, I like to think like, this and this is like specific things that if I do this, I'll be a better Christian. And I have to catch myself and remind myself that it's revolving around the relationship with Jesus and being in Jesus. So I just think this, at least the first part of this verse, saying that what the law could not do and that it was weak, just thinking that the law was weak and God is strong. Like
yes.
God can do that part. God did that part. I think it's very, very comforting.
God did. What the law was weak to do, God was strong to do. I love that language.
Yeah.
I hadn't thought of that before. The law was weak, but God is strong. And God did by sending his own son in the likeness of sinful flesh on account of sin. He condemned sin. I just love this idea. Sin condemned us. Sin condemned you, but God condemned sin. Sin condemned you to die, and so God condemned sin to die. It's just, it's incredible. God condemned sin.
Yeah,
there is there now, therefore, and it all comes out of chapter 8, verse 1. This the entire chapter is coming out of this resounding idea. There is therefore now no condemnation. Why? Because God condemned sin. There's no condemnation. It's a little bit like the double jeopardy idea. Do you know what double jeopardy is?
Yeah.
The idea of, in the United States here, we have a law that if you've been tried for something and you've been found to be either innocent or guilty, I guess it's a little bit different if you're guilty, but you can't then be tried a second time.
Oh, okay.
Right?
So you can't be found innocent and then be found guilty later.
Right. Like if you've been tried and you've been found innocent, and I actually watched a movie back when I was kind of into this. I watched a movie that I don't know. Anyway, the premise of the movie was, I'm not recommending watching this movie, but the idea of the movie was like, this woman had been found guilty for something that she actually didn't do, which was like, I think it was like killing her husband or something like that.
Mm-hmm.
That's what, and he kind of like set it up and then he escaped. That was the premise of the movie. And so the whole movie, she's trying to prove her innocence. Anyway, but after that, she had served in jail for like 5 or 10 years for the murder of her husband.
Right.
And then she got out and her husband had become, anyway, the premise of the movie, the very end of the movie, she kills her husband, but it's like, the idea is like, she's already been guilty and she's already gone through the punishment. So you can't be tried again. Like that was the end of the movie. That was a double, and I think the name of the movie was actually Double Jeopardy.
Wow.
Not recommending watching this movie. It was a total waste of time. I watched it when I was probably like a very young teenager. Anyway, that's the idea here, is that God condemned sin to death. So sin's not coming back, right? Like that was already taken care of at the cross. You're like, it's already been taken care of. God condemned sin to death. So there is therefore now no condemnation if you are in Jesus, if you've been baptized.
Right.
Paul says the same thing in Colossians. Or he writes to the Colossian church, and he says, if you've been baptized, if you're in Jesus, your life is hid with God. You're saved.
Yeah.
Did he know every individual there and all of their journeys? No, but he knew that they had been baptized. So they're in Jesus, and they've been saved. There's no condemnation.
Yeah.
I don't know if you have anything that you want to jump in on that, but
I just think that, yeah, like, that can go both ways. Like, if God has condemned sin and sin is not coming back, and he's declared us innocent, we can't be declared guilty.
Yes.
That's just so, like, I feel like we do that to ourselves. We condemn ourselves. It's almost like sin isn't condemning us, and so we do the job for ourselves.
Yeah.
And forget to kind of lay it all back on Jesus, because he can handle it.
Yeah, God's shoulders, put it back on his shoulders, because God's shoulders are infinitely broad, right?
Right.
And I actually really like this idea a lot. I don't know if you and I have talked about this idea before, but God's shoulders were infinitely broad, right? You've heard the term before, an infinite price. He paid an infinite price, right?
Mm-hmm.
So think about it like this. However many number of people have been in existence from Adam until now, or not even until now, but until Jesus comes back, that's a finite number of people. Right? I mean, how many people is that? Billions and billions. Well, there's like 7 billion alive right now. So let's say there's been like 100 billion people alive in existence from Adam until Jesus comes back, right?
Yeah.
Now, each one of those people has committed a finite number of sins, right?
Mm-hmm.
And it's a huge number. I mean, how many sins have been committed? It's in the trillions or maybe hundreds of trillions. I don't know that number.
Yeah.
But it's a finite number because you have a finite number of people committing a finite number of sins. And any finite number multiplied by a finite number equals a finite number.
Yeah.
So Jesus' shoulders were infinitely broad at the cross to take care of every sin. It's not like God looks down and says, oh no, that's one more than we accounted for.
Mm-hmm.
Like that just doesn't, no, it's already been taken care of in Jesus. That's why there's no condemnation. All sins have been taken care of because he suffered an infinite cost.
Right.
Does that make sense?
That's so funny because just the other day, someone said to me that Jesus didn't die for everybody. He died for who he knew would be saved. And I thought, no, that doesn't work like that. He, like you said, infinitely broad shoulders to hold an infinite amount of sin, whether you choose to hand it over or not, right?
Yeah.
And I just think that's beautiful. Like, he wasn't counting out, like, this is how many people are going to be here, so, okay, we need 100 children, whatever.
Moving the beads.
Yeah.
Yeah, yeah. Making sure.
He just made provision for everybody.
Yeah, every single person. And it's just so amazing, God's wisdom here. He suffered an infinite cost so that any person, like, he doesn't look down and he's surprised. He says, oh no, you did that? Like,
yeah.
Now you've pushed yourself just one too far. I didn't account for this. No, he has taken care of an infinite price.
Right.
I think the person that would be studying along with Paul here would perhaps get to the place now where they would say, well, if all sin is forgiven, then I can keep doing whatever I want, right?
Mm-hmm.
And Paul is about to say, God forbid, right? And why don't you read verses 4 and 5?
That the righteous requirement of the law might be fulfilled in us who do not walk according to the flesh, but according to the Spirit. For those who live according to the flesh set their minds on the things of the flesh, but those who live according to the Spirit, the things of the Spirit.
I love that he jumps into that.
Yeah.
Those who live according to the flesh set their minds on the thing of the flesh, right? God wants you to be fulfilled. This is the same idea that you had before. Now, there's this really cool thing in mathematics called set theory. I like numbers a little bit. So this is a little bit kind of cool. There's ways of organizing numbers, right? In sets, right? So one way that you could do that, and you're gonna have to follow me a little bit, is there's a bounded set.
Okay.
And the best way to explain that is probably like if you had like 10 or 15 cows, what you would do is you would bound them in a fence, right? But what happens if you have like 10,000 cows? Like if you have a ranch with 10,000 cows, instead of building a fence around them, it's too large. There's way too many, right? So that would be what you would do instead of bounding them is you would build a well. And the cows would never leave the well because they would have the freedom to go and to walk wherever they wanted to walk, but they would always come back to the well.
Right.
You would drill a well. And so that's called a centered set, right? Everything is centered in this. And I love that Jesus is the water of life because everything in Christianity revolves around him. It's not stay within these lines and these rules. No, you stay around Jesus. You're not bound. You're free, right? We've already read the in verse 2, Jesus has set me free. God's desire is not that you would be controlled, but that you would be free to do what you were designed to do, to be fully human, to follow the law, and to be the happiest version of yourself. But you're not confined now to always choose the same clothes, the clothes that, you know, or whatever.
Yeah.
I don't know. God says you have tons of freedom here. It's the same thing in Garden of Eden, right? You have tons of freedom, but stay close to me. That way you don't go off and you dehydrate yourself.
Yeah.
I don't know if that makes sense, but
makes
bounded
sense.
Sin versus a Yeah.
It makes me think of two things. Number one, it just makes me think of the way that God draws us to him and doesn't, like, push us or, like, he's yanking us over. He's just saying, like, hey, like, I'm the safest, most peaceful, yeah. most sensible place to be, so come to me. And it also makes me think, like, I grew up not centering Christianity around Jesus. And I think that made it so easy for me to just stray away because it wasn't, like you said, I wasn't around the well.
Mm-hmm.
And
yeah.
so it's like once you realize that the whole Bible and all of Christianity just comes down to Jesus, it makes it, you have such a stronger connection to what you believe.
Yeah.
If that makes sense.
Yeah, I love that you're saying that. I think a lot of us as Christians have struggled with this at one point where we thought everything revolved around either our law keeping or like keeping ourselves within the lines. No,
right.
It's centered in and around Jesus. And when you're centered in and around Jesus, as long as you stay around the well, like God convicts you and he changes you, right? He sets you free. But I just love that we just read in verses 4 and 5, the righteous requirement of the law might be fulfilled in us who, again, we're not walking according to the flesh, but we're walking according to the spirit. For those who live according to the flesh, they set their minds on the things of the flesh. Those who live according to the spirit, the things of the spirit. Jesus is the thing to orient your life around. Sports, not the thing to orient your life around. My career, not the thing to orient my life around.
Right.
My career is important, right? I want to benefit the community. I want to help, right? But I'm not, like, Jesus is the thing that I want to orbit my entire life around.
Yeah.
He's the well. He's the thing that's going to keep me grounded. I love the word that you've used,
yeah,
stable and secure. Yeah.
Yeah. Another thing I really like in verse 5 is where it talks about minds.
Mm.
And last night we were having a devotion and we were talking about minds and we were talking about your mouth and we were talking about how you talk and how your words mean so much. But it made me think of this condition. It's called pseudocyosis. And it's basically where a woman wants to be pregnant so badly and thinks she's pregnant so badly that she has every symptom of pregnancy, aside from an actual fetus. And it's like, I'm telling you, it's real. It's like, it's a real, condition. And I always think of that and I'm like, our minds combined with probably hormones and all of that too, but like our minds are powerful and what we think about ourselves or about God or about what we believe is so powerful. And so it just makes me think when it says, like, it starts with setting your mind
right.
on the spirit.
Oh,
and everything else
I love
follows.
The connection you're making. Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. When you set your mind on the things of the flesh, it's going to follow that. Or if you set your mind on the things of the spirit are what's going to follow.
Right.
So I actually thought it'd be really fascinating to talk a little bit about the law and to go back to Rome, to Exodus chapter 20.
Ooh, okay.
And talk a little bit about relationship as we kind of start to wind this down. I wanted to talk about the first four of these commands and something that you and I have kind of talked about a little bit before, but I don't know if you would remember this idea or not. So in the first four commandments, in chapter 2 of Exodus chapter 20, it says, I'm the Lord your God who brought you out of the land of Egypt. You, verse 3, you shall have no other gods before me. Now, that sounds to me a lot like what I said to my wife when we got married. I said, I choose to have and to hold, right? I'm putting my affections on you as my wife and no one else will be in front of you, right? You're the number one. You have my affections. You have you have all of my emotions. And then the next commandment, you shall not make for yourself a carved image. You shall not bow down to it. That's verse 5. Well, what part of you do you make? And what part of you do you bow down?
Well, you make with your hands.
You make with your hands, right?
And you bow with the rest of your body, I guess.
Yeah, like with your knees and
yeah.
you bow down. So I love what God is saying here. He starts off by saying, give me your emotions. Then he says, give me your body, right? And then the next one would be, you shall not take the name of the Lord, your God, in vain.
Right.
What do you use for that?
So that's your mouth.
That's your mouth.
With your words.
Yeah, with your words. And then the fourth one, remember the Sabbath day to keep it holy. And then that would be the essence of time.
Right.
These four things are the essence of any relationship. Paul is here. He's been talking about the law and what the law was, what its purpose was and what it was not meant to do. It was not meant to save you, but it still holds a purpose.
Mm-hmm.
And so here he says, well, not him, but God is saying, give me your mouth, give me your body, give me your affections, and give me your time. If I told my wife that I would give her three of those four, that relationship would be compromised. It wouldn't work, right? If I told her, hey, honey, I'll give you all of my emotions and my affections, but my body is reserved for all women. Like, or if I just told her, hey, I will reserve my body for you and I will reserve my emotions for you, but my time is actually dedicated to other things. That's not a good relationship.
Right.
To the degree that you give your spouse and your children and your friends, to the degree that you give them these things, that relationship is going to be strong.
Right.
And to the degree that you take away one or more of these things, that relationship is going to be weak. And I love that the law is centered in a relationship. That's really the essence of what I'm trying to pull out here.
Yeah.
God says, give me your words, give me your emotions, your affections, give me your body, and give me your time.
Yeah.
And we'll have a strong relationship.
I think that's so beautiful when we like come back to talking about the law being about what's best for you. And I just think if we look at it that way, rather than like God saying, give me your emotions, instead of saying, you're saying you're jealous and I can't have any other gods. It's
mm-hmm.
like you get to view God in love, which
mm-hmm.
is what we're talking about. The law is love. And if you view it that way, it makes it, it doesn't even feel like you're keeping a law or a set of rules. It feels like you're just bonding.
Yeah, I love the way you said that. You're just bonding. Chapter 8, verse 1, it says, there is therefore now no condemnation to those who are in Christ Jesus, who do not walk according to the flesh, but according to the Spirit. The four things that we just mentioned, that is the stuff of which relationships are made, right? And I love the word that you used. You used the word bonding. We are bonding with Jesus. It's not as if there's no condemnation because God is looking down and he says, you've been doing so well, and I am now impressed with you. No, it's because we are in Christ Jesus. I just want Jesus to be the centerpiece of my life, right? The thing to orbit my entire life around. I don't know anything like you want to add as we kind of make the appeal here, but like, I don't want to orbit my life around things that are, and I love the idea that you had, insecure, unstable, flimsy, flabby. Jesus is secure. He's stable. And so if I want to orbit my life around him, I know my life is going to be stable.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I think what I take out of the whole thing, especially as someone that is soon going kind of a little bit more out into the world, into college and stuff, is just that, just stay close to Jesus. And like you said, not that I don't have to worry about being a good person, but I don't have to worry because God did.
Because
right?
God already did.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. I really deeply want for myself and for, you know, for you and for anyone, like, we can't become blasé or indifferent or mechanical about our devotions, right? Oh, there's another Sabbath, or oh, I'm doing another devotional. No, this is the thing to literally center your life around. Jesus is so incredible. He's so amazing. He's so beautiful. And I just want to bond with him. I love that word. I want to bond with him. The law is about bonding. It's the law of love, right? Orbit your life around him. Don't become so routine that it's just, oh, another, you know, no. This is the God's mercies are fresh every single morning, right? Lamentations chapter 3. God's mercies are fresh every morning. Orbit your life around Jesus. There is no condemnation for those of us who are in Christ Jesus. Okay? Do you have anything you want to add?
I think that's all.
You think that's good? Okay. Do you want to close us with prayer?
Yeah, sure. Dear Heavenly Father, thank you so much for what you've done. Thank you for your son, Jesus. Thank you for the verdict you have given us, that you have freed us from the weight of sin. You've taken it onto yourself. I pray that as we continue to go about our days in this world, that we will learn to set our minds on things of the Spirit so that our bodies will follow our minds, and that we will just continue to grow closer to you, that we won't think of the law as what saves us, but that we'll remember that you are our Savior and that you've already done everything. I pray that you will just continue to give us joy and peace and guide us, Lord, closer to you. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen. We hope this was a blessing for you. We pray that you'll join us again next week for part two. And I will have a different guest. Sahai did absolutely excellent. I was really impressed. And I expected nothing less. She's an incredible thinker. She's preached for me several times and helped me teach our Sabbath school. So I expected nothing less, but Jesus is amazing, right? He's blessing the young people. And I pray this was a blessing for you and that you were able to gather something and that it's just drawing you closer to God. So we'll see you next week, and God bless.
theme. Earth and heaven will pass away. It's not a dream. God will make all things new that day. Gone is the curse from which I stumbled and fell. Evil is banished to eternal hell.
No more night, no more pain, no more tears, never crying.
All around now the nations bow down to sing. The only sound is the praises to Christ our King. Slowly the names from the book.
There's a mansion.